Hi, this is Sophia Yates. We're on the Sim film strip. This is the art of virtual reality for the new and experimental media, a collective presentation featuring a virtual cast of characters who work in a 3D virtual world, a platform for creative self-expression. I have 13 speakers that are going to introduce you to the virtual world of Second Life and how they apply it to the real world and their real life's work. We have a representative from the University of Western Australia, Jayjay Zifanwe, and
Hi. And
he is the manager of the physics department at the university. Is that correct, Jayjay?
Yes, that's right.
Could you tell us a little bit about the virtual campus of the University of Western Australia?
Well, the virtual campus came to life in 2009, and this was a kind of a spin-off or like a second or third stage of what started out in 2007 as a little virtual world we created on a server sitting on a computer in our campus, and then we moved to Google Earth, where we had the university, or we still have the university up in 3D on Google Earth, and then we moved on to Second Life, and initially we just wanted to set up the campus and have the campus available for people to walk around, and we wanted to only have the campus, you know, exactly as it was in real life. But through serendipity and meeting a lot of wonderful people, many of you sitting around me today, things developed, and it didn't become just a place to go walk around in. It became a place where teaching's happening, architecture, we have research going on, we have art, we have machinima, and we also have a lot of collaboration with universities around the world, including University of Illinois, University of Texas, there's a Swiss university that we work with, and numerous others. So well, that's a quick rundown of what we're doing at UWA.
Can you tell us a little bit about the Google Earth competition, the contest that you were awarded?
Google Earth ran a competition called Build Your Campus in 3D. And it used basically Google SketchUp to build the models, and then you had to kind of geolocate it exactly as to where it was in terms of the real life footprint on Google Earth. And so this was the Australasian competition open to universities in Australia and New Zealand, and University of Western Australia came out tops in that, and we had national publicity in that. There was a national paper which carried photos of the team that took part, including the buildings that we created for Google Earth. We had publicity in the Science Network, Australia, lots of other places, and because of that, the ragtag team, which came together through a bunch of emails, mm-hmm. got to be known by the Vice Chancellor of UWA and by others in facilities management, it allowed us to start building a little nest egg to put towards Second Life.
Mm-hmm. How was that? How was the university, the virtual university, received at the real life university? How did you approach people? As far as creating a presence and having the faculty above you accept that?
Well, the publicity that we got from the Google Earth competition, that kind of gave us a bit of,
an edge?
It gave us a bit of cred, because we were in the national paper, and many researchers would like to get in the national paper, and we were.
Right.
So, that gave us some credibility, and then we went around. I went to see many heads of school and asked them to put $1,000 in to get their building into the virtual world. And, we got about $10,000 that way, and went to the Vice Chancellor and asked the Vice Chancellor to match the $10,000 we had, and he did, we got so $20,000 to start with, which was a good sum to start with, and we bought the sim, and we could, you know, pay some people to build, you know, the initial campus. So yeah, I'm like, and that's how it started.
Mm-hmm. And can you tell us about some of the classes, the lectures that you hold there on the campus, on the virtual campus, and who participates in those?
Yeah, well, we have Professor Wade Halverson. He's he was a professor in business at UWA, and he used to run classes in second year units and in masters by coursework units as well. So, you know, some of the units that he taught included electronic communication strategy and buyer behavior and decision making, and he would interweave Second Life into these units. So with electronic communication strategy, he basically was teaching his students you know, marketing strategies using emerging technologies, and that's what Second Life is. And with buyer behavior decision making, they had to kind of compare buyer behavior in Europe versus in Asia, etc. And using Second Life is a great platform to get to know people from all over the world, and the students could easily access people from overseas using that, and they were able to you know, reach a global audience using Second Life. So that's one thing. Right now we're building the School of Anatomy and Human Biology. So and we're working with the University of Kentucky on this project. Yeah, University of Kentucky. They have they have a cranial nerve center in Second Life where they teach their students, you know, how cranial nerves work and look and where they're positioned, etc., using some very detailed models they've created in Second Life. And they have loaned one of their models to UWA, and that's sitting at the site of where the anatomy and human biology building will be coming up in the next, well, within the next 3 weeks.
Right. Now, you had an exhibit with cranial models, nerve.
Yeah, that's right.
Was that part of that? That was a few years ago?
No. I mean, this was few weeks ago.
Oh, a few weeks ago. Okay, because you did have an exhibit at one time that was near the arrays,
the Square Kilometre Array. Yeah. I mean, like, there's there is a volumetric, well, there's a scan of a brain there using volumetric data. So I mean, like, the way there's a 3D model of a brain, and you know, like, there's a research area that we have on our land, and there's a number of things there, including, I mean, DNA and molecules and things like that, and you know, mathematical formulae and mathematical patterns, like something called a Menger sponge.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, like, that's a very important mathematical construct. Not that I know too much about mathematics, but there's a mixture of mathematical objects and research objects at that site. Yeah.
Okay. How have your students received Second Life? You know, when I've been on the sim, I see a lot of students trying to build and construct things. Now, how are you interacting with them in real life and in Second Life? How do they perceive Second Life themselves when they're first introduced to it?
Well, the students don't actually have a lot of time in Second Life.
Mm-hmm.
You know, for them, it's a unit, you see. So they come in, and like many of them do it as a unit. And then when they finish, you know, they move on to the other units, and they don't really have time to invest further when they finish their unit. So for them, it's about getting through the unit. And you know, it's a bit unusual, and you know, like, it lends an extra dimension to their studies. And I know that they find it interesting, but you know, there's so much going on in terms of other units after that. So once it's over, they move on.
Right.
Yeah.
So this actually, all right, because I do know of some local universities, you know, in the state of Massachusetts where they have electives for Second Life where they can take a class. And it is just one semester, and, you know, they learn the basic skills, but they really don't know that in the future how they can apply this type of platform, this environment, to, you know, their real career when they get out. Like, and this is what this panel, we're sort of a more mature panel of residents, you know, we're seasoned pioneers here in Second Life. And that's what I'm trying to show them, is that there is life after college, is that this, the, you know, that unit that they take in at the university, try and hang on to it, because, see, this is where it's going. This is the trend. This is the future.
Yeah. I mean, like, all units that a student would do in a university are, you know, I mean, like, it's about making them global citizens. It's about, you know, making them able to think for themselves and, you know, to give them, you know, critical thinking skills and stuff like that. So, you know, none of the units, I think, you know, they apply a whole lot of it to, you know, when they finish and in their career. It's about making them a more all-rounded, you know, person, you know, who's versatile and able to, to adapt, you know. So, and I think Second Life does a lot of that, you know. It allows you to interact with people from all over the world. It gives you some additional skills. It challenges you, and it helps you see things in a different way.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Just a few more questions. I'd like you to explain a little bit more about the contests and the events that you hold that are affiliated with the university there. And it does not include this, you know, it includes the students, but it's the community of residents in Second Life that have all joined in, and what they're providing for the university, what you're seeing from the residents from around the world that are participating in your events. What are you coming away with, and what do you, what is your take on this personally?
Well, the art challenges at the University of Western Australia and the machinima challenges have kind of formed almost the foundations of the or the backbone of our activities in the virtual world. Things like, you know, lectures and, you know, research or talks here and there, or serious academic pursuits, they happen from time to time, you know, during semester, etc., when there's a class or something like that. However, we, with the art, you know, and with machinima, we're kind of almost open all year round. Machinima especially is something which, you know, it's kind of is the tool that we use to break this barrier between real life and Second Life,
right,
where people are able to appreciate a virtual, you know, what happens in a virtual world a lot more easily, because then they don't need to log into Second Life. All they need is YouTube, and they can see what happens. And of course, when we're trying to show an audience machinima, we show it in the best light, and they don't need to deal with less of some of the amazing things that you can see. And only then you actually bring them in, and then you know, they can go through the difficulties of learning how to work in this world. It's not actually that difficult to operate in the virtual world, but it does take time. It's the same as you throw someone into PowerPoint who has never used any Microsoft product at all in their life. They're going to struggle hugely compared to someone else who has a lot of experience in Microsoft Word. You know, and if he goes to PowerPoint, he can basically, or he or she can basically understand the basics behind it. They know how to save a file. They know how to copy paste. They know how to, you know, they know how to do all those things. Instinctively, they can see, you know, what they need to do. But someone who has never used any of those products will struggle, obviously. And same with Second Life. You know, you need to spend some time to learn, and might probably be a good time to show the video called Pillars of UWA to the audience.
Okay. Petlove, do you want to cue that?
Yeah. Say thank you, Jayjay.
Thank you, Jayjay.
Hey, Emma.
Jayjay, how do you, personally, I'd like to know, like, where do you see yourself in the next year? And how does the university feel about how far it's come, as far as its presence?
Yeah, I mean, like, the university has accepted Second Life. We got support from a lot of different places. Many of them are really interested in it, but don't know what to do with it. You know, I mean, like that's my take. You know, like that they know it's there, they like it, but they don't know exactly what to do with it, and they kind of, you know, don't bother me too much. When I'm running it, so no one tries to to stand in my way, so to speak. I do get a lot of requests for presentations to groups of people who come visiting, to student groups who come to visit UWA. Student services will ask me to do a presentation. I've been asked to do a presentation on the 20th of this month by a group that does home education in Western Australia. So it's they're having this education fair for all the people who are homeschooled, you know. And,
right.
And I'm
That's
doing a
excellent.
Presentation there.
Yeah.
I'm flying to Malaysia on the 24th to the Digital Education Show Asia at Hilton Hotel in Kuala Lumpur, and I'll be giving two talks on Second Life there, which is great.
Wonderful.
I have been invited to Brazil, to Sao Paulo, in November, and we're working out the logistics with that. So that one's, that one's on the cards, but I don't have my tickets yet or anything like that. So, you know, like that one, is likely to go ahead, but I'm still kind of working on things there. The art challenge, with the 3D art challenge, closing date's 30th of May. We already have about 36, 37 artworks on display. With the film challenge, the closing date's the 30th of June. We have about 12 or 13 machinima in.
I'm
we
working
have the
on mine.
Okay, that's great.
Yeah, yeah.
We have the defending champion, triple defending champion, Tutsi Namaratna, Frenchman in India. His work is in already, Narcissus, and that was submitted yesterday.
Wonderful.
So things going well.
All right. I have one question from the audience. Are you involved with the antenna array at the university? And
the
how
Square
is that going?
Kilometre Array. Yeah, the Square Kilometre Array, that's been something that Australia has been desperately trying to secure over the last number of years, and last year we were successful. The site is going to be shared. The Square Kilometre Array is an array of 4,000 radio telescopes spread out across Western Australia and South Africa. So South Africa and Western Australia were in this battle to get the Square Kilometre Array, and in the end it was a draw. So the international committee that was looking at where to award the Square Kilometre Array, they decided that it should be split across these two countries, and it's actually part of my department of the School of Physics. We have an entity set up within the school called ICRA, or the International Centre for Radio Astronomy Research, and that's full steam ahead, and will be. And it will be a highlight for the next 30 years, really. It's the largest, or once it's set up fully, it will be the largest ever built in history by a factor of 100.
Right. That's what I had read. Okay.
Yeah.
My husband has a few questions he'd like to ask.
Do any SETI work, research, or is it strictly radio astronomy?
We do have other telescopes. We have optical telescopes at UWA. You know, we have telescopes. We have something called the ZEDCO telescope, which looks for NEO or near Earth objects. These look for actually comets and things like that, or meteors which come close to Earth or which could potentially hit the Earth. And so that telescope is part of an international is part of an international group that looks at these types of things and tries to detect them, and we get students involved, and some of the students actually found objects which in space which had not been detected before. We have optical astronomy, but with the Square Kilometre Array itself, that's purely radio astronomy.
All right, thank you, JJ. I appreciate everything that you've just, you know.
Yep, no worries.
Thank you so much. You can go to bed now.
All right, thank you, everyone, okay. And good luck with the rest of the rest of the day. You know, LaPiscean, Secret Gracie, Petlove, Claudia, Puki, DB, Imo. I will say good night.
Sweet dreams. Nice to see you. Have a good night.
Night, JJ. Take care.
Great. Good night. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Good night.
Good night.
That was Acer.
She says, hello, everyone.
Hello, Brian.
Hello.
Shh. The avatar you see here is the ghost artist of a Toronto oil painter. My interest in virtual worlds began with an attempt to create an artist unaligned with a real-life identity. The idea was to determine if a virtual character existing only in a virtual space could become successful and accepted as an artist in real life alongside flesh and blood ones, with my first life not influencing how people interpret my creations. I see what artists do in virtual worlds as the frontier to a new medium with the capability to create unique forms of art. The question was whether established curators or art historians would accept what Bryn does is indeed considered art. So far, Bryn's work has been shown at Nuit Blanche, the World Expo in Shanghai, at the Madrid Pavilion, with IBM, in movies such as My Avatar and Me, or in projects with people such as director Peter Greenway, or working with artists such as Stellark and Calfe. My work has been presented at Web3D in Paris, France, profiled on RAI TV in Italy, and with Art 21. Bryn exhibits in various universities worldwide and is also on the syllabus of many. Currently, she is the subject of 3 thesis works and has just received a new media grant from the Canadian government, Ontario Arts Council. Recently, Bryn was written about in Vogue magazine in Italy and exhibited at a museum in Rome, as well as the Santa Fe New Media Festival. I am currently working with Peter Greenway on Dance Macabre, an installation slated to open in Switzerland for November of 2013. So they will all essentially deal directly with the cartoon, knowing nothing about the user. It's been interesting. For this talk, I will try to focus more on what drew me to using virtual worlds as an art medium and what unique traits some forms possess over more traditional mediums such as painting, sculpture, or cinema. The longer you can keep someone connected to your artwork, the better. Once their attention leaves your work, you may have lost their focus permanently. Beside me is a painting done by Mattia Preti. I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing it correctly. It is a good example of how to create an eye path for the viewer. The term eye path generally refers to how your eye subconsciously moves around within the composition of an artwork, in this case, a painting. Essentially, when you view an artwork, your eye usually enters from the bottom right side of a painting and follows in a counterclockwise circle moving from focal point to focal point. Some artists are aware of this phenomenon and will work on the 2D plane to lead the viewer's eye around their artwork in an endless cycle. They are attempting to keep the viewer's eye in the artwork for as long as possible, as the eye can leave a painting quite easily if the composition is poor. Your eye will be drawn to and follow contrasting colors such as white against black. The high contrast will draw your eye there subconsciously. I will put in some white prims to help show the area I am about to speak of. In this example, you can see high contrast in the foreground, figure's leg against the white tablecloth. The angle of this area of contrast leads the eye upward towards the right-hand side to where a woman is pointing at the central figure. Your eye follows her gaze and finger to the focal point of the entire painting, which is the murder of Amnon by Absalom, son of King David, for the rape of his sister Tamar. Now, if you were walking down the street and saw a group of people looking in a shop window, there is a very good chance you would also peer inside as you walked by, just out of curiosity. Point at something and other humans will look automatically. Cats won't, but humans will. Your eye will also follow what figures in a painting are looking or pointing at. It will also move to unique areas that stand out. So if a painting, for example, is made up of a majority of triangular sharp shapes, the eye will naturally be drawn to a single soft circular shape because of its uniqueness within the artistic environment. Same would be true for a painting composed predominantly in blue, which had a small area of yellow in it. Your eye would typically go first to the yellow portion. In the painting before us, all the figures are vertical, whereas the main character, whom the artist wants you to focus on, is horizontal. If you look at the dark strip of black in the center of the painting, it contrasts strikingly against the blue area on its left side and the assassin's hand, which holds an important narrative element to the painting, a knife. Both knives are hard to see against the dark background, which forces the viewer to focus on them longer or notice them at a later time. When they are discovered, the eye studies them longer because they are a found object with a sense of mystery. Your eye follows the angle of the blade directly to the face of the figure. And a process called triangulation is used, whereby the assassin's eyes also look down to the figure. This creates the shape of a triangle which circulates the eye within a smaller cycle. I will put down some more prims to show this. Your eye will eventually break free of this knife area and move on, then be caught elsewhere to again be cycled within the artwork. Look at this painting for a moment and see how your eye is drawn to the central character. I have marked down some of the directional lines which lead to the main character. All these things are used to lead your eye there and keep you within the painting. As you can see, the artist has created a very strong composition to not only draw you to the central figure, but to also keep your eye within the painting for an extended period of time. Each time your eye wanders to the border, it is caught and sent back down to the center of the painting. But this is all looking on a 2D surface that is static. You often will stand back in a gallery and view a painting from 6 or so feet away. The artist can control you subtly, with these techniques, and you can be immersed to a degree as you imagine what is happening in the scene. Now suppose in this gallery a very pretty lady or handsome gentleman walks by, or your cell phone rings. The connection between the painting and yourself is strained or possibly broken. The artist wants to immerse you, but they are not strong enough to fight against your cell phone or other distractions. So there is a level of immersion, but it is quite fragile. Suppose we now look at cinema. If you go to a movie, you have a seat. Then the lights go dark to reduce any distractions around you. The movie screen is very large to block out your peripheral vision. They want your vision to be dominated exclusively by their narrative. They don't want your view moving past the border of the screen to be distracted by elements outside the movie itself. There is, of course, the big glowing red exit sign, which always reminds you that you are not in the movie, but rather watching a movie. Somebody has feedback really loud. Things like the exit sign are little barriers that keep you from being fully immersed. The goal is to eliminate as many barriers as you can. That is one reason why I keep text directions and arrows out of my artwork. They impede immersion because they are constant reminders that you are viewing a constructed work rather than existing within it. The theater then turns the sound up high so that you are again dominated by your senses. You won't hear others talking so easily and are then less likely to be distracted and thus have the immersion broken. There is a narrative and each scene has its own composition. Big image, overpowering sound, darkness outside the border, and hopefully a narrative able to captivate. But with cinema, you are a passive observer to the story. You do not interact, but remain separate from the medium. Once the movie ends, you can restart it, but the narrative is fixed as well as the camera movement. It will never change regardless how many times you watch it. We can see by these examples of traditional artwork how mediums strive to keep your attention and immerse you, but there are limitations and obstacles. Now here is a true story. I am a Canadian, but I used to study in Europe for a while. In Florence, actually. One time I took a trip to Paris and went to the Louvre. While there, I desperately wanted to see the Mona Lisa. I found it, but was dismayed to discover a huge crowd around it like fruit flies on a strawberry. I tried to get close, but I'm not the pushy type, which you kind of need to be, so I lingered around the outside of the crowd, and being pretty short, I was unable to see the painting very well. But, as the fates would have it, the fire alarm went off at that moment. Everyone left the painting, and within a short time I was alone with the Mona Lisa. I was not about to leave because of a fire alarm. The Louvre is obviously not going to burn down. So I had the Mona Lisa to myself and looked at it for perhaps 10 minutes. That is a pretty long time to stand and look at something, though it doesn't particularly sound long. Yesterday, someone contacted me and told me how they were enraptured by my virtual artwork, Imogen and the Pigeons, staying there for 5 hours. 5 hours is more than most, but it's quite common for people to stay for well over 2 hours, and it is very common for people to return and go through the artwork alone or with friends half a dozen times. So what does that say about the potential of this medium? Why can some people spend so much time with a virtual artwork? The painter works diligently to keep you engaged with their artwork, but think back to the longest you have ever been immersed by any artwork in any medium. Cinema is perhaps the most effective for immersion, yet the viewer is not really a part of the experience. They are not an active participant, but rather a passive observer being told a story with a scripted camera narrative. A virtual work can keep the viewer engrossed for a longer period, and perhaps this is because the viewer is actively experiencing the artwork. I have said in the past that I think of my artwork here in virtual worlds almost as paintings you can enter and explore. The beauty of a painting, the immersion of cinema, and then that meshed with a new type of freedom of movement combined with interaction. A creation which can use tools such as ambient sound, duration, narrative, mystery, interaction, identity, emotion, and so forth, the same way an artist's studio may contain tools such as brushes, wood, clay, paint, wire, canvas, and wax. The viewer in a virtual environment can be an active participant who has the ability to choose their direction. They need not view a static image nor follow a scripted camera. A painter knows generally where the viewer stands in front of their painting so they can plan ahead, as we saw with Preti's painting. In cinema, they also lead you from event to essential dialogue and so on, often in a recognizable formula. You don't break away from their fixed camera. You are led by it. You can't stop and look inside a desk drawer or behind a door. The nature of a virtual artwork is not only that it can be interactive, but also because it can be open-ended, meaning you use your own creativity to interpret and move within the environment, and the artist knows they must work within a new compositional frame where they can't control exactly from what angle the viewer observes or interacts with their artwork. So now we can see how various mediums interact with the viewer, but perhaps now the question is whether a virtual space can compete against a First Life gallery or museum space. I will explain now how it differs from my exhibition career as a painter. As a painter, I have one or possibly two large art openings a year within the gallery. Each show lasts a month and has an opening reception. The opening night reception is essential to attend and do well, as there are literally hundreds and hundreds of artists waiting in the wings, always trying to take your spot within the gallery. If you have had bad sales for a show, then you are suddenly on shaky ground. The opening night is where the vast majority of sales or future sales come from. A few years ago, Toronto, remarkably, had a tornado. I mean, Toronto doesn't have tornadoes. I don't know if we have ever had one. And anyway, that was on my opening night. Yay!
You're doing so well, Secret.
Yeah.
Other artists get scheduled during the bitter cold and snow of February and deal with winter storms, etc.
Oh no, it's live on the internet.
Quite a bit really rests on that opening night, and you just pray for sunshine and warm weather. The opening reception might get, I am going to guess, around 300 people over the course of the night, all with their backs to the paintings, chatting and drinking wine. Then each day for the rest of the month, there's a trickle of people popping into the gallery. Again, I will guess and say around 30 people a day. I really am not sure, but for the entire exhibit, the vast majority for me are local residents of Toronto, as would mirrored in most cities. With Imogen and the Pigeons, a recent virtual artwork of mine, there have been just under 25,000 visitors attending from all over the world since its opening January 13th, and there are no real adverse times or weather conditions. Some days saw 1,000 visitors, and the average was about 350 a day. Visits have ranged from an hour, 5 hours, to actual days in length. I am in a guessing mood, so now I will guess that nobody has ever stood and looked at one of my paintings for an hour solid. I think it's safe to say that nobody has stood for a half an hour either. Think about it. What is the longest you have ever been immersed with an artwork? Could you lose yourself in the Mona Lisa for 5 hours? For a while, I have suspected that the virtual medium, as an immersive art form, can easily compete against other strong mediums such as traditional 2D, sculpture, or cinema. For example, a gallery or a museum would be ecstatic if they could keep their guests entertained for 5 hours inside a structure housing centuries worth of masterpieces. Or, in regards to cinema, I recently saw the Hobbit movie, and it was 3 hours long. And it felt like it, too. Few movies would dare attempt to go longer than that, and I don't blame them. Watching a 3-hour movie is pretty much the ceiling for me. So why can someone potentially spend more time in a virtual art environment than in some of the other mediums? What are the differences? Well, there are many, but one, I think, is the challenging nature and rewards of interaction combined with immersion. We need not be passive observers in a virtual environment, as I said earlier. We are a participant within the artwork, rather than a visitor separated and left sitting inactively while being told a story. I also believe that a degree of difficulty is effective in order to create a bond between the viewer and the artwork. It creates a sense of direct connection and achievement that is lacking in the interaction between a viewer in a gallery looking at a painting or someone watching a movie. The difficulty is finding the balance between the artistic environment being frustrating or else wise rewarding. There are also other interesting elements associated with virtual environments.
More people?
For example, people have told me for years how they met their best friends or partners while exploring one of my narratives. Virtual artworks can also be social experiences. Imagine trying to socialize with a stranger during The Hobbit. It would be annoying, but perhaps not so in a virtual environment. All those whom I have spoken to, who pass a climbing part in my latest artwork, literally climbing a precarious virtual stairway that builds itself as you progress. They talk about having had clammy hands or feelings of fear of heights when navigating. They talk about being nervous and truly anxious for fear of falling, their mind fooled and reacting as they are fully immersed and physically invested in the story. And when they do finally reach the top, there is a feeling of achievement, and for some, exaltation. The visitor is definitely part of the narrative now. They are not watching someone climb, but rather doing it themselves. A misstep could result in a fall, and at worst, the actual death of their avatar. There are repercussions for mistakes, but the challenge for myself was to find a balance where it was meaningful rather than frustrating for the viewer. People spend a long time in my work for a variety of reasons. It is the challenge, the emotion, and narrative, the interaction and sense of discovery of secret details, the layering, and because parts are often social. You can go with a friend and help each other navigate or discuss the narrative. At the beginning, I usually am around the artwork to help people with the difficult parts if they need it. But what always happens is a form of social guide emerges in the community. People who overcome the obstacles in the narrative, finding little secrets along the way, who then bring others to share their discoveries, who in turn bring others, and so on. They discover elements of the artwork which they know the majority have not uncovered, and this makes the build special to them. The more difficulties they overcome or layers they uncover connects them deeper emotionally to the artwork. Anyway, these are some of the things which fascinate me about this new art form, and trying to recognize why it works so well. Hopefully, you have also found these things interesting.
Thank you, Brian O. That was a wonderful presentation. I've never seen this before, this one. And it explains so much. Can you hear me, Brian O? It was a great explanation of how we all...
She said, thank you for listening.
Yes, I did listen. And we recorded. And
can I make a comment?
Yes, please.
How did I end up having to follow Brian O's presentation?
Well, I don't...
We all have different viewpoints. I don't think any is more valid or less valid. I think we all have our own little niches.
Well, that was a fantastic presentation.
Yes,
it was very informative. It was tightly organized. And there's no one that I respect in Second Life more than I do Brian O. She really is a serious artist who has taken this to a level of seriousness that no one else has.
Right.
And she's a role model for all of us on how to finally get this into the real world art world.
Yeah.
And she does not hear, by the way.
But he's absolutely right. I don't think a lot of people have sat through this particular presentation. due to disruptions and things like that that have happened in the past. And so she finally got to get through it. And it's fascinating because she's absolutely right. She brought us into that painting, and she explained a lot about how we all, really have not really looked at things the way an artist has. We're not really, thinking about how we're perceiving art and how the artist is trying to portray a piece of art. So, yeah, she pretty much broke it down for us and explained how she is. So
also, if I might add, Bryn brought a couple of videos to the studio today with her. Did we want to show two of those or anything?
Yes, I'd like to do that, and then we can take a bit of a break, and then we'll get right into, we're going to do our virtual tour with D.B. Bailey, and we can send our camera person to his first landmark, and allow him to get familiar with that sim and res, and then DB and I will go together. And so we'll take a little bit of a break. Is that all right with everyone?
Okay, I told her that you're going to show the vids, and she said, oh, cool. And then I told her after that a break. I think I'll tell her anything else she wishes to say. I'll go ahead and speak for her. Mm-hmm.